Hello, everyone, and welcome back. I'm Nathan Novak from Right Taiwan, and my partner in crime, Mike Fagan, is with me from Taiwan again today. And Mike was just sharing a recent experience he had with, was it your neighbors, Mike?
No. God, no.
God, no. Okay.
Not my neighbors, no. My neighbors are fine. I get along with very well with my neighbors, except two.
Okay.
Or three, further up the alley. No, it was this... I live in a little house in Tainan City, close to, it's in North District, but it's actually really close to the center of Tainan City, and really close to Chang'an University, which is NCKU. And behind my house, there is a large park, Haiyanlu Park. And there's a road separating that park from the road, the terrace road in which my house sits. And between that road and the terrace row of houses, there used to be a small car park, which the local government saw fit 2 years ago to change into an additional small park rather than a car park. So I used to have people parking their cars outside my kitchen window, and fine, it was no problem, it was fine, it was okay. And it was really useful because it's free parking for local people, right? So if you live nearby and have a car, you can park it there for free, as long as you get the space. So it was not like one person owned one space, which is you can park wherever you can find a space, it was fine. So that was great. There were never any problems. And then the government destroyed the car park and they turned it into a small park with like little flagstone pavement, they put down some grass, they put like a little wooden pavilion and some little saplings to make it look more attractive, some little wooden benches, and at either end is like a little area with sort of soft tiling where you can play badminton. I used to play, me and my girlfriend used to always play badminton there. But there was an unforeseen consequence to this, which is that the park then became occupied by homeless people. So there's like these two or three guys, homeless guys, who hang out at the other end of this little park behind my house. And one or two of them in particular who recently have been annoying me. So we have to go back a week or two ago.
No, I'm stopping here for a minute. Consequently, to any of our viewers who are not actually in Taiwan, I think it's important to mention that. I think you know, compared to other cities that I've lived in D.C. and these places, I think that... maybe you have a similar experience, but I think homeless people tend to be fewer, relatively fewer, compared to a lot of Western cities, at least in my experience. Like my experiences in Europe and also in Washington, D.C., where you have homeless people begging on every corner. Typically, in my experience, I see homeless people, I mean, I live in Kaohsiung, which is even bigger, quite a bit larger population than China. But I very rarely actually see homeless people on the street. Usually it's like begging near a train station or something like that. That's where I usually see them. Is that the same in China?
Okay. Yes, it's the same. I agree with you. Yeah, I used to live in Edinburgh in the UK, and I actually had to, as one of my part-time jobs, when I was a postgraduate student, I used to work in a church, and I often had to deal with problems related to homeless people, sometimes with mental health issues, and walking up the street, and you know, causing havoc sometimes, and having to call the police and do. So Taiwan certainly does not have the homelessness problem to the same degree as we have in the UK or from what you're saying in the United States. I mean, I've heard it's really bad in San Francisco as well. So, but no, it's not really bad in Taiwan. It's just this area close to the university, this local park. There are some old houses that have been here for decades and decades and decades. Like my house that I'm living in now is probably about 50 years old. You know, it's a real old little brick house, just a little two-story house. And so anyway, I'm not exactly sure where these people came from, but they're there. And they sort of live in the park. They've sort of taken over the one section of it. And about a week or two ago, it was two weeks ago, one of these guys was I went up to work and I came back at, I think it was lunchtime. So I was out working in the morning and I came back at lunchtime, and he got a little camping stove and put the camping stove on the wall directly outside my kitchen window. So the distance between my kitchen window and his camping stove is literally like a foot, like 12 inches. And above that is the camping stove where he'd been cooking earlier, and he stopped when I got there. There's my balcony, where I have clothes hanging up to dry. So now my clothes all smell of whatever it was he was cooking, which I'm not even sure it was. So I went out, I looked at the window, I couldn't see very much, I couldn't really see anyone. So I went out around the back, and his camping stove was on my wall, his bicycle was propped up against the wall, and he was laid out on the ground in the park, just, you know, he was out of it, he was asleep. So I gently took down his camping stove, moved it across, and put it on the park bench, and I moved his bicycle as well, just so, you know, that he would hopefully that he would get the hint. You know, if you want to cook, go cook somewhere else. I'll cook on the kitchen wall, the walls of my kitchen. And, because apart from anything else, it's a fire hazard, it's a potential fire hazard. So, I don't know, I remember coming back from work one day and finding that my house is on fire, you know? So that went out. I didn't make any comment about that. I just sort of moved his things and I went back to doing what I was doing. And then, was it the same week or this week? I think it was the same guy. He was outside my kitchen. He was outside my kitchen window again, and it was early in the morning. So this is my dog. She's this is the little one again.
They look fairly young.
She's about 2 years old now. Look at the camera because it's exposing my beard belly.
Well, better
beard
belly than other things, I suppose.
I think it was this week I went around and I was early morning, so I was asleep upstairs on the second floor. And he was downstairs on the outside playing his radio on full blast volume as loud as he could. And I was like, oh man, it's 8 o'clock in the morning. I'm holding out a line, it's the weekend, you know, I wanna sleep, I went to bed late last night. So I was like leaning over the balcony, I was like trying to get his attention, but he was just like, he was out of it. So I just got on with what I needed to do. So I let that one go as well. And then there was another episode last week where I think it was this guy and another guy, I don't know if he was homeless or not, but one of my dogs woke me up at 4:24 in the morning. I just remember this because looking at the phone. 4:24 in the morning, Coco starts barking. So, and when Coco barks, it's really loud, you know? And so he wakes me up. It's, what the hell? It's 5:01 in the morning. And I can hear the sound outside. So I go, what are they doing now? So I go up the balcony and I look down. And they're chasing a bunch of chickens. There's like three or four chickens, I mean live chickens, running around, making little cook sounds, running around outside my house in the little park. No. My dogs live in the house with me. My dogs are downstairs in the house with me. I'm talking about the homeless people outside. If my dogs were chasing chickens, it would be pandemonium. No, there's no way. So these homeless guys are trying to chase these chickens outside. I'm like, it's at my 4 in the morning. I'm like, hold on a minute. Number one, why do you lot have a bunch of chickens in the park, right? Second, why are you chasing them around at 4:30 in the morning?
Yeah, Taiwan also has.
What is going on here?
Disturbing the peace or disturbing the public laws. Like after 10 p.m. most nights, you can't make
Yeah, but also the laws of the park. So you're not allowed to have wildlife. You're not allowed to use the public parks as a farm, basically. You're not allowed to barbecue. You're not allowed, there's a bunch of things you're not allowed to do, which get roundly ignored all the time. But anyway, so I leaned over the balcony and I was like, why is it? I was speaking Chinese to them, and I was telling them, you can't. This is not a farm. You can't be having chickens here at 4:30 in the morning. And so they were, they were like, okay, so it's apologetic. And so they managed to get the chickens away somehow. So that stuck in my mind. And then a couple of days later, this homeless guy's outside my kitchen window again, and he's got his bicycle right up against the wall at my kitchen window again. His music on again. And he was making some sort of noise. I couldn't hear it at first because I had my headphones on because I was listening to some YouTube video. And then the dog started barking, so I was like, what? I said, again? So I went out and looked, and I couldn't see anything. So I went around outside, and this time I saw the guy, and he had one of those like chicken cages, a cage in which you would keep chicken, like you would see the traditional market, and he had this, and he was doing something with it, and he lifted it up on the wall, right next to my kitchen, making a lot of rattling around, making a lot of noise with his bicycle. I was like, what? So at that point I got angry, and looking back in retrospect, I probably should have been a bit calmer about it, but I got angry and I was like, I lost my temper a bit, and I started shouting, and I was like, get the fucking thing down, And I walked up to him, and he was like, whoa, smaller. I was like, get that thing down now, and he wouldn't move it. So I took it off him, I grabbed it off him, and I threw it across the thing. And I moved his bicycle. I didn't damage his bicycle, I just moved it gently. And I was angry, shouting, like, get the hell out of here. And I can't go to sleep because you and your chickens. I can't. You sit down here with your music, disturbing my dogs. I can't. I got to worry about my clothes because you're cooking, all this stuff. And he was all right. So he was doing the pathetic, doing all this. And so anyway, I just stopped, and I walked off, and I went back to my house to do my thing. So I got back in the house, and I got back to doing what I was doing, and then I could hear this shouting outside. What now? So I went back, and I opened the kitchen window, looked out, and now he was angry, and he was shouting, and he wanted me to fight. I got angry, and I went out, and so earlier I'd said to him, I said, if you don't leave, if you don't go to another place, I'll call the cops. I'll call the police on you, which is what you're supposed to do. So I had half a mind to go around there and just punch him. And I thought, no, do it the right way, or the official way. So I went to I didn't have a phone number, so I just went to the police station. It's just around the corner. So I just ran around the police station, explained things to the cops in Chinese. And so they went, okay. So they came over, and we went over there, so they came over, and when we got there, he was gone. He was gone. And then we looked around, and but he picked, while I was gone, he picked up a stone and threw a stone and smashed my kitchen window. I'm not gonna take a laptop through the kitchen because I can't bother to move. I'm looking at this mosquito on the wall, I'm worried about. And he smashed my kitchen window and then disappeared. So the cops were like, well, there's nothing we can do if he's gone, we can't find him. So anyway, they talked to his mate, the other homeless guy who was asleep at this time. And they were speaking Taiwanese, so I couldn't understand. So I can do I can speak Chinese, and I can understand most things in Chinese. But when it's Taiwanese, then my comprehension just drops like a stone.
I'm guessing from context.
Yeah, I'm guessing from context most of the time, yeah. So I know like a handful of words, but I'm guessing what they're saying from context. But yeah, so anyway, so the cops left and they said, they gave me the phone number, they said, if he comes back, give us a call and we'll come and talk to him. So the cops left, and right after the cops left, I'm talking to the, I'm still stood there talking to the other homeless guy. And when he was talking to me, he was speaking Chinese, and his tone was all very, what do you call it, sort of apologetic and reassuring. So, oh, you must understand that we have so many problems, because we're homeless people, you know, like this. And then out of nowhere, the other guy comes back on his bicycle. And this time he's picked up a stool or something, and he looks like he wants to hit me with a stool. And then they both of them start speaking Taiwanese and asking me some sort of question, which I'm guessing from context is like, you know, they're going to fight some. Now it's a 2-on-1 situation. But that doesn't matter. I mean, that doesn't matter. I think I'd be able to take them both on. But the smart thing to do is to back away, call the cops, have them come back, because they've already been out there. If I start beating them up, the cops are going to know who's done it straight away. So I backed away. They looked like they wanted to fight, but they were a little bit unsure. So these guys are—they're a little bit older than I am. They're like—I think they're probably in their 50s or something. So, you know, I'm still 37, so I'd be all right. But they were not sure, so I backed out, and I called the cops again, and the cops came around, and they were still stood there shouting stuff at me. So the cops came around, and the cops talked to them. But then they were speaking Taiwanese, and I can't understand, so I left it. And I found out later, the cops said, basically, we've warned them, and what we want you to do is if they cause any more damage to your house or to, you know, or cause a rock, is it you can, what they said was, you can go around, call the cops, call us first, and then go around and try to keep them there, so that when we get there, we can do an arrest. Like you can do a citizen's arrest. You can like hold him, physically hold him, until they get there if necessary. And I'm like, yeah, but I mean, that's going to start a fight, and then I'm going to end up smacking one of them and putting him in the hospital. So and then it was like, well, the cops said basically you just have to protect your head. You're not allowed to hit them back, but you've got to protect your head. So. So what happened next was the next day, I can't remember if it was later that night or it was the next day. My other neighbor he wrote a message to me, put it under my door, saying in Chinese, saying that they started squatting in the house next door. Okay, so to explain, the terrace that I live on, there's my house, and then to the left of my house, on one side of my house, there's another house, and I have a neighbor there, an old man, and then there's another large complex for the house, and there's a large family lives there, but they're fine. But then on the other side, on the right side, so to speak, there are four houses which are owned by a doctor who bought them some years ago and wanted to renovate them, but found some difficulty with the local planning regulations, and so gave up on the project. He still owns them, but just didn't do anything. And so they've been abandoned for a number of years, and they're falling into rack and ruin. And, you know, like windows are broken and hanging off, and the cats live, basically the cats occupy them. So these two homeless guys, because it was cold even though, they basically climbed over the wall and started squatting in this in the house right next to mine. And I could hear them one night. I could hear them, like, making noises and stuff. So I told the neighbor across the street from me that the neighbor across the street has one of these houses that's been redeveloped, and it's huge. It's like a little mansion. And they're members of the Rotary Club, and they have meetings on every Tuesday night. And so the daughter of the old couple who lived there, I spoke to her, and she's okay. So she said she'll talk to the Lingzhang, which is like street captain, and then the street captain would then talk to the Lingzhang, which is the borough captain or borough warden, and then the borough would then she'd be able to do something. But the so she talked to the Lin Zhang, which is the street captain, so to speak, and he put a notice around the back to warn them that they can't squat illegally in someone else's property, even though it's ransacked. Otherwise, the cops can come and arrest them. And if they don't leave immediately, they'll call the cops on them. So they left. One of the homeless guys is still there, though. And he's still hanging around. And he makes these strange noises sometimes. He's just like wandering around the park. So he's probably got some sort of mental health issues. Since then, I haven't had any problems. I was kind of wondering whether I did the right thing. I think in the end, I think I probably did the right thing. Looking back, I probably would have tried to not get so angry when I saw him with the cage, the chicken cage, you know, like outside my house, and just try to more calmly, you know, persuade him to take his chicken in his chicken cages and go elsewhere. But I just got annoyed because this was like the third or fourth thing in a row, you know, and I got annoyed. But so far it looks like it's
my very first apartment.
It's done and dusted. It's over now.
I was young and stupid. Out of all places. Those of you who are watching from Gansan, I apologize for saying this.
I remember you said that. Yeah, you said in Gansan. That was the thing.
So good that I've actually never been back there one time.
Gansan
is 9 years after I left. So I've been in Taiwan for 11.5 years. I moved to Kaohsiung about 9.5 years ago, and I never once went back to Gansan. Not for any reason at all. I think I drove through it one time, and that's it. Yeah, just because my experience there was so wonderful. But I purposely avoided it.
I've driven through Gansan like a million times on the way to Thailand to Kaohsiung and back again. It's just. I mean, you can avoid it. Like, for example, if I want to drive from Thailand to Kaohsiung on my motorbike, I can, or in a car for that matter. Well, I mean, obviously the car you can go on the freeway, but if I'm driving on the motorbike, there's a bunch of ways I can go, but there's really two ways. There's a third way, but it's longer, so I don't usually bother with it. And the two ways are about equidistant, Tsapudong, which is approximately. So one is just take Sendawi, which is Highway 1. And I run straight to Gansan. So you go Luzhu, Gansan, Chaopo, Nanzi, Kaohsiung. And you go run through Gansan. And the other way is you go to the Tainan Gaotia, the HSR, high speed rail station. And then you take a series of small, little known farmers' roads through a series of farms in Alian district. And then a couple of twists and turns. And that eventually brings you out at the foot of the dam at Agongin Reservoir, which is next to Gansan district, between Gansan, Arian, Yentiao, and the Tianyang districts. And then you go through Yentiao, and then you end up in another road that takes you down straight to Yuanyu, and then into not Niaosong exactly, but just the same. It was a Tianjin Lake area in the ocean proper. So either of those two ways is fine. But Gansan is kind of interesting town because it's like the Agongin Reservoir, which is really, 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 really interesting reservoir, but only interesting for me. It's a lot more complicated than that. But it's just an elaborate puddle, but Gansan township itself, it used to have, before the administrative shakeup where they changed Kaohsiung City, Kaohsiung County to just Greater Kaohsiung, it used to house the Kaohsiung County Immigration Office. So this is kind of interesting, and it was the same deal in Tainan. So if you live, for example, as I did when I lived in Kaohsiung, if you live just outside the border of Kaohsiung City, really just across the line in Niaosong district near Tianjin Lake, where I used to live, and you lived and worked, you thought of yourself as living and working in Kaohsiung City or just outside the city, but you work out in the city every day, as I did, you nonetheless are not allowed to, you were not allowed to go to the immigration office in the city. You had to make a trek all the way out to Gansan in the county, which was it's not that far. If you know where you're going, which you don't the first time you go, if you know where you're going, it's about half an hour drive, or half an hour, 45 minutes drive. And it's before Google Maps, and you don't know where you're going, and yeah, it was a bit of a pain in the bum to get there, but I got there anyway. Actually, it wasn't so bad finding it for me, because I'd already been there on the train for another reason. But Gansan also has another interesting problem, which is that the underground sewer system, the wastewater channels under the town, are actually inadequate from what I've read. They're too shallow, and they need to be redone. They need to be re-engineered. And the problem is that when you have a typhoon, they fill up with water very quickly, and the water overflows onto the streets. Now, so a lot of that water is going to be wastewater. So you now have a situation where it's not just flooding, you've actually got a health hazard because you've got wastewater all over the roads. But spending money to fix that is expensive, you know? And I feel sorry for people who live in Gansan who would like the government to sort that problem out. I can't see it getting done, you know. But anyway, that's another task.
Well, it's actually my wife's aunt actually doesn't live too far from there, so they were saying that they were.
Oh, the explosions? Yeah. I saw that on YouTube. That was amazing. That was scary. That was.
Yeah, it was quite early. I don't remember the exact time, but they were. It was bedtime.
It was also like 4 in the morning, so wasn't it 2 in the morning?
Flash of lights and the flames had shot up. The way they described it, so. No, I'm in Zoid, yeah, so this was quite a ways from that, but it sounded pretty hard.
You didn't hear that, because you're all the way over in Zoid, right?
Typically, that things get solved, so
yeah. It's
a disaster, but the active disaster is more than anything, so. But, speaking of, today is 6 years since the tsunami in Japan, 3/11, when we were filming this.
That phrase.
But yeah. Anyway, my. I remember. I mean, I've got stories from Gansan that we'll have to have other videos where we talk about that.
I remember. Yeah.
I mean, like for example, my first experience, my first day. Now I came to Taiwan in July, the evening of July 1st, 2005. So this must have been August 1st, 2005. I was walking my first day, my very first day. I was, you know, still jet lagged, and in all honesty, I was a little bit hungover because we had kind of a big party in my hometown the night before I left, and then I didn't sleep the night before getting on the plane. I had to get on the plane at 6:30 plane to leave from Minnesota, where I'm originally from. And so, I mean, I was dehydrated and I was jet lagged and everything. I'm just walking down the street with my back when people used to have iPods in Gansan. No sidewalks, you know, and I had, back when people used to have iPods, and I was listening to music, trying to get my
in Gansan.
What I was doing and where I was, and I mean, we're probably
going
to have several episodes on driving here, but this is my
first time
driving. There was an old woman, and you know how they call them, like, I'm not really certain about the difference between Asan and Appa. I don't know if you've heard these terms before, but it's like describing old women, right? And you know, for some reason, I've seen a... Huh? Obasan. Yeah, well, the way that my wife says it, like Obasan.
Well, you missed out the other term, like Obasan. Obasan is the other term.
But I think most of our viewers who have been in Japan more than maybe 3 or 4 years know some of the locals that have heard this before. But anyway, and one of my friends had a meme a few years ago that I saw where it's it's quite sexist, but it is in many ways, you know, things that are cliche sexist. In some ways, they come from a kernel of truth, right? And he had like this timeline of like Taiwanese women, right? And it was just a cartoon, right? And he had the 20-year-old where she's really slim and sexy, And then the 30-year-old, where she's slim and sexy and has two kids. The 50-year-old, you know, right before menopause, she's still slim and sexy. And then menopause.
Well, I think I've seen it. I've seen it.
Current mayor of Kaohsiung, right? And then she's not. And the sunglasses, you know, and the, you know.
Oh, pasta. Mayor of Kaohsiung. The curly hair, right? The round-shaped curly hair.
And then she's 90, and then she's
like, the jam jar sunglasses, yeah.
That tall, and yeah. But she's really thin, yeah. And anyway, she was this. Anyway, the reason why I'm mentioning this is because this the woman that I saw was.
We're basically the same thing, just changed the grade.
Driving a motorcycle, made a left-hand turn on the wrong side of the road, driving towards me.
I saw that.
If you can imagine me, very naive, coming here.
Exactly what those people there.
This is not the original story, by the way, that I was going to talk about. We got sidetracked, but that's okay. She's driving on the wrong side of the road, probably within a couple of meters of me or whatever. And of course, there are no sidewalks in Kaohsiung, so you're kind of walking, dodging, you know, parked cars and things like this.
Yeah.
And I saw her coming, and she had a helmet on, but it was not strapped. And she was like, literally, I'm walking, and she's driving past me. If you can imagine her, this was her when she saw me. And keep in mind, she's driving.
Mm.
Like, to the point where she's, like, rubbernecking it behind her, looking at me, and I'm just like, what in the... You know, this is my first experience with this. And later on, I realized that I was, like, the only other foreigner in Taiwan besides my boss's husband. So I was kind of, an anomaly there. And I was just like... And I remember, I even took my earphone out, my ear pod thing, or my... What is it called? One of these things, yeah.
Yeah, you would
have been. And I remember just kind of like, and I was just going to put my earbud back in when all of a sudden I heard, and then it,
The earphone.
Because she was not paying attention, and I looked over my shoulder. She was looking at me instead of looking at where she was going, and she hit a parked car. And when I looked over my shoulder, all I saw was this old lady kind of like, I don't know if like you can see this, but she was kind of like with her, I'm looking at her back, and she's kind of like this on top of the car. And you can just see her back. And I was just like, what? And then, like, and I stopped and looked back. And then this guy ran out of the, I think it was like one of those goat's meat restaurants or whatever. Goat meat. He comes out and starts shouting at her. And this is before I knew any Mandarin or Taiwanese. So I was just, I just kept going. Yeah, I just kept going. But you're probably his car or a customer's car.
Yeah,
he's,
everyone,
you know, that kind of thing. But that was my first experience.
It's his car, right? Yeah.
But anyway, getting back.
Well, because it'll be his car, right? Yeah.
My first experience with neighbors was also quite interesting at Kaohsiung. I had an elderly woman. And I don't know. Well, they're squatting. They're squatting. They're squatting. They're squatting. I mean, they could move in.
Okay. By the way, these were not neighbors. These were just homeless people hanging out because the government changed the car park into a park.
Yeah. They'll be moving. They'll bring it.
They were. They're not now. Right now, but they're just sort of hanging out at the park on a permanent basis, I guess.
She in Kaohsiung. No. That's a completely different story. Yeah. Oh, neighbors are wonderful things. Let me tell you. I don't know if you've had any other experiences with neighbors, but
this is neighborhood, the apartment, right, where your wife's sister
constantly. And for me, I'm like, okay. She was like, the way she explained it to me in very, very broken English was that. Yeah, no, she was asking for,
you buy a car or something, right? Like $100, which in Taiwan, which is a small amount of money, right? It's like 2 quid or something like that. It's like, $3 or something.
All right, I'll lend you $2,000. You know, whatever. Yeah, see, I was stupid, you know, and I come from, and as a country boy, I come from the countryside where a person's word is gold or whatever. Someone owes you money, and they don't pay you back. Basically, you can take it out on their skin. Then I realized that she was never going to pay me back, and then I realized that she must have been doing some very interesting work, because this woman was probably 60, and usually I find that with women in Taiwan, if they look 60, they're probably older. Like, if you see a girl and you guess she's 25, she's probably 35 or 40, which is a wonderful thing, but, you know, when I met my wife, I guessed that she was 10 years older than she was when I met her, you know, just because of, I don't know if it's skin care or health care or beauty care or whatever, but anyway. But I had a girlfriend at the time, and she came to visit me in my apartment, and we opened the door, and then she was standing outside, my girlfriend was standing outside, and I was about to let her in, and I saw my neighbor come out, and she had this, like, wig on, and she was dressed, like, really kind of like you would guess a hooker to look. And, and so that's, never did get my money back. Never did get my money back.
60-year-old hooker. There's a, no, well, there's a, around the corner from where I live, there's a, there's like one of those little shops, what do you call them, like, just like a little convenience shop, but it's not a franchise, it's not a 7-Eleven or a Family Mart thing, it's just like a little corner shop, and there's just this old woman who runs it, and she's like 60-something or whatever, and she has this, sometimes she stands outside when there's nobody there, and she's got like a hula hoop, and she does this hula hoop thing, and, just down from there, there's this, just down the alley. She's got a hula hoop, right? She just does a hula hoop thing for fitness or whatever, I'm not sure. Anyway, the alley down from there, there's one of those places with, you know, what do you call it, the little, I'm not sure what the word for this is, even in English, the little, like a plastic sort of tube with bright colors, and it turns around and around, like a barber's pole. But the way that where a barber's pole would be red and white, because the red is supposed to signify blood running down, because in the old days, barbers were also dentists. This would be like many different colors, like orange, blue, green, yellow, and it's got like lights, right? And now, what I didn't know when I first got here, and I found out subsequently, was that. When I first got to be in Taiwan in general, was I didn't know what those were, and then I saw hairdressers' places that had them, right? So if you want to get your hair cut, they had them, but they had like different ones. So sometimes they had the bright colors, sometimes it would be polka dots. They had different ones, and I just assumed, for example, there was in Kaohsiung in Sanming District, Sanmingju, which is the nice posh, relatively posh area of Kaohsiung City. You'll know. Oh, possibly. I'm talking about the nice area, then probably the nicest area of Sanming. Just out from the lighthouse. And you know, they've got that little channel, water channel, and it's like a nice park, and they've got the pink weeping willow trees and stuff. So it's nice. Yeah, I can't remember what it's called now. It's years since I've been there. But basically, I don't go there all the time. I live there. And there was a series of, on one of the roads, there was a series of hairdresser shops, right? So, normally I would go get my haircut somewhere else. But there was one day I wanted to get a haircut and I didn't have time to go to the normal place. So, I had to get a haircut for some specific reason, like I had an interview or something like that. So, I forget what it was now, but I went to the first one and it was busy. There were people getting haircuts and there were people, like other gentlemen, sitting down waiting to get haircuts. So, okay, so I went to the next one, and it was the same deal, like there was a couple of guys already waiting. So then I went to the next one, which was strange, because even though it was daytime, it's still strange, all the lights inside were turned off. And there was the doors were open, right, so you could just walk in, but there were no lights on inside, and there was nobody there, and I was like, strange. And then a woman came out from the back, like a younger woman, and she said, oh, okay, shall. Like, wait. And she went upstairs and she was calling someone's name. And so I was sitting there waiting and I'm thinking, should I just leave? Should I just go and look for another one? And then this woman came downstairs and again she looked like she was in her 50s, I think. And as you said earlier, the clothes was like the what you'd expect from a prostitute to wear. And then she sat me down and said, okay, you want a haircut? And I sat down and she cut the black thing, you know, because the little robe thing that they put over your clothes, your hair. And I sat out and then I could hear this block upstairs. And then it suddenly dawned on me. And then I just occurred to me as she washed her hands. I sat through that haircut the whole time, just grossed out. But I was, for some reason, I was afraid to say anything. I'm not quite sure why. I was afraid to just get up and leave. I was like, oh, it was extremely uncomfortable. But then I figured it out, right? Some of these places are legitimate hairdressers, right? And, but some of them are not. And it's like an older woman, like in her 50s or whatever, 60s or whatever. And she's moonlighting, she's doing, you know, this other stuff. So that's probably what you were, yeah, that's probably what she was. She was an old, aging.
Socks and whatever before they became popular, you know. And these new, even my girlfriend was like, who is that? That's the neighbor that owes me money. Like, do you know? That was literally her face. And she was like, do you know what she does? I said, well,
they probably.
And she said, she looks like she works in at night. You know. I see you're dressed this way. I put two and two together, you know. But yeah. And this was like my girlfriend came to visit me like quite late at night. Like it was like I got home about 10 o'clock and this was probably like 11. Usually I didn't go out too late.
You know?
And she came after her work and she came over to my apartment and that was the first time that I had been like there when she was the lady was leaving, yeah.
I'm kind of surprised your girlfriend was so understanding, because, you know, the way you put it there, like, your girlfriend turns around and says to you, who's that woman? Who's that strange, what, that horrible-looking woman there? And then you turn around and say, oh, that's the neighbor who owes you some money. And
I'm not going to pass any judgment.
And she just, oh, yeah. What have you been doing?
She could have been, like, my grandmother. If she were, you know, 30 and respectable, you know, then maybe she could have jumped to a particular conclusion. Yeah, then I would have said, oh, I don't know her, yeah, at all. No relationship. Yeah, but well, that in, I mean, just
you would have thought about it.
Just not a person you'd want to see naked. Yeah. Anyway, you can.
Oh, but it was because it was clearly. Yeah, I mean, clearly it's just the age. She's just so minging and so old, and it's just like, it's impossible to even think about. Yeah.
My roommates when I was in university, had all these, he was a big collector,
and he was just a comedian. Go to Germany, you can sit naked for free. Oh, right? Go to swimming pools in Germany, honestly. Having a beer and watching comedy,
it was freaking Ron something, I forget it, Ron White, I think it is, I don't know if you're familiar with him, very, very American comedian in the sense that, I mean, probably only he was doing this kind of like doing a stand-up routine where he was saying he was at a titty bar, you know. And it's just like this old grandmother or whatever, and she's like, you wanna see my titties? And he's like, yeah, I do, you know. And then she's like, woo, and then at the end she's like rolling them up, and I just about threw up. It was one of those things. It was like, you know, like an envelope just to get to the stick to
no.
Yeah, just we are recording this, by the way. this is probably wrong in Taiwan, not right Taiwan, but yeah, I've got all sorts of, well, actually, for the most part, besides that, mentioned earlier about my sister-in-law bought a house a few years ago, that neighborhood is diabolical. Yeah, well, you have occasional neighbors, like the place we live now. My mother-in-law is deceased. I never met her. She's been deceased for a long time.
Right.
But this is
just those neighbors then, right? No.
Well, it's not a house.
You haven't got a list as long as you're on.
As I said, it's a dotto. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And we've got neighbors across the way. There's a little courtyard in the middle of the building, and there's kind of a square. Yeah. And like tonight, if I
apartment,
my room here, and
apartment. Yeah.
We've got neighbors that never. their lights are always on. I mean, you get up at like 5 o'clock to go do your business in the bathroom or something, you know, 5 a.m.
Yeah.
Lights are on.
Yeah, so it typically is, yeah.
He'll be exercising in his underwear, like on the balcony. Like he's got to be 80, and he's just exercising in his underwear at 5 a.m. or 4:30 a.m.
See, that's cool though. That's a really cool thing in Taiwan. That one of the major differences. Like, I really want to do a video where we talk about really just really great things about Taiwan, like good things about Taiwan that are if not unique to Taiwan, are certainly different from what you would see in either England or the United States. And one of the things I think is the way that old people in Taiwan take their own health seriously, and the fact that. Well, I was going to say that. That's exactly the next thing I was going to say, and I have a bunch of funny stories about this. So, you know, like, but first of all, I mean, if you go to a park in England, where are they? You'll see, I mean, apart from the usual, you know, trees and fields, you'll see, you'll probably see a duck pond, which will be, you know, like 2 or 3 feet deep at most. A bunch of ducks and people throwing bread for the ducks. You'll probably see some swings and maybe a slide for the kids, right? And then that's it. And the rest of it is just flower beds, some trees, a lawn, you know, a bunch of lawns, and a gardener taking care of them, you know, shears and stuff. You might occasionally see it like a bowling green. That's a public park in England. Now. That'll be it. That's it. There are no sports facilities, and so as a consequence of the fact that there are no sports facilities in the park, and there are no sports facilities elsewhere except perhaps at the local school or university, which might be too far away for local kids to get to. So what you'll do is, if you want to play soccer, for instance, football, you'll take a jumper off, a sweater, and you'll put, you know, four lads. You'll put your jumpers down and use those as goals and just play football there. But in Taiwan, you go to a park and you'll almost certainly see two to three sites within one park where there are a bunch of permanent steel exercise machines specifically for old people. You may or may not also have a small, typically this is rare, I think, you may or may not also have a small, very, very small slide or climbing frame for children. Really? Okay. In Thailand, there's only the park behind my house has one, very small one. The other park doesn't have, and a bunch of other parks also don't have. There's another one that does have, so it's kind of, they might have a couple of like slides for kids, but they certainly will have exercise machines for the old people, and they'll have a variety. Well, the pull-up bar is not so much for the old people, that's more for like, pretty much me, I'm the one who uses it, and they just hang, yeah,
just
hang.
It's just like, is he ever going to come down? Hanging upside down, yeah.
And put a pair.
I think.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, it's a good thing that they don't have more than like a bunch of, like a colony of bats, right? Just, you know, put a bunch of wings on them. The old people really, there's a lot of equipment and money spent on exercise equipment for old people. And as you said, they will get up at like 5 o'clock in the morning and go outside. Like one of the things I have done, like for example, last night, so my girlfriend comes over last night and she stays at my house. She lives in another alley, a bit further from where I am. So it's very easy for her to stay at her house or stay at my house. It's okay. And okay is either way. So she came up to my house last night and stays at my house. And we don't have to go to work this morning, so we can have a lie-in. And so I wake up at like, I want to wake up at like We got to bed late. We're still talking late at night, and we're just having fun. And now I want to sleep till like maybe 10, you know, wake up at like 10, something like that. Is it quite lazy? Because during the week I'll get up at like 7 or something.
The clapping.
So I want to be able to get up at like 10 maybe sometimes. It's okay. And I can't. And the reason I can't is because the old people are outside, like doing the massage. This, you know. And then right outside my kitchen, I can hear them, the little benches down there, just, you know, trying to get blood flow. Yeah. And, walking around doing this. And it's amazing. But it's really good for them, because in England, the old people, if they go to the park, they'll go to the park during the daytime and during the sunlight hours. And they'll tend to go to the park more during the summer months than the winter, because it's really, really cold. Really cold. And there's nothing there for old people. So old people really kind of, in England, they kind of, to a degree, they kind of forgotten about. But in Taiwan, no, there's a lot more, they're more, much more the center of political attention. I think.
I remember like my grandmother going for a walk or something, but she would never get up at 5 a.m. and go outside and do, you know, a lot of the, what is it called, the shadow boxing or whatever it is. You see some guys in the shadow boxing or whatever, and their Tai Chi or whatever it is, and Tai Chi. But I think part of that reason, I don't know, I don't want to jump to conclusions, but part of the reason I think that maybe you see that so much is that, you know, no one in Taiwan, especially in cities, has a yard. Like, basically, there's no private place to do any of that stuff, yeah. But this guy here, I mean, he'll be on his balcony at 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning, and he'll be on his balcony in his whitey-tighties, you know what whitey-tighties are, right? Okay, and he'll be, and it's just, yeah. But then, like, sometimes, like, I can be woken up because at 3 a.m. his wife is just shouting at him and they'll be fighting, you know. And I remember one time I was here for, this is before we moved in, because my wife's...
Walter White, yeah.
Again, I mentioned this is my wife's, my mother-in-law's house. My sister-in-law also lives here. And we came here for, I don't remember if it was like a birthday or something. And we were here late. I think it must have been Lunar New Year, because sometimes we stayed over for Lunar New Year. Oh, no, it was when my wife had our son, she did the, they call it the Zhuyuanzi, it's like the month-long break that a woman takes, yeah, and I stayed that night, because I think my son was having a little kind of colicky, and so I ended up staying here that night, and I remember sleeping on the sofa, and they were, like, shouting and screaming at each other, and then they woke up my wife, and my wife was, like, concerned that they would wake up my son, and she came out, and then the wife from across the way, you could like see them, because they don't close any shades or anything. The lights are all on. It was like 3:26 a.m. Like I had my phone with me. It was at 3:26 a.m. And I remember checking my phone, and she was like hitting herself. The woman was like shouting at him and hitting herself. They were speaking in Taiwanese, and my wife was kind of translating for me quietly, because she didn't want them to see us watching them. And she's like, yeah, she's trying to like give herself bruises because she's threatening to take him to the cops for abuse. It's like, just the weirdest crap. So there are definitely pathologies. Jump on car, yeah.
Well, that was this.
That's
that story that keeps you can see on YouTube and stuff, where in Taiwan, where the fake car accidents, where people with no money or with little sense will just run into cars and try to take the driver to court. They'll purposely try to get themselves run over. It's insane.
Take their head. If that was take his head and bash him into the windshield. But they've had to buy the little camera. You see people on motorcycles. With like the little Kaiser Wilhelm thing on it, and then like a camera on top. You got one.
I've seen it. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, you need those. Yeah, it's crazy people. Anything to.
Yeah. No, I've got one. I've taken it off now. I got the same one as you. Good. So. GoPro. Little, yeah, I got one. Actually, I don't. I haven't used it for ages. Actually, I used to use it all the time. I don't use it much anymore. Can't remember why I stopped using it. I don't know. I remember the I need to get a new memory card for it. I just forgot about it. It's just one of those things. I had to get a new memory card for it, and then I forgot I was doing a bunch of other things, and I just started gathering dust. I should probably start using it again. Yeah. Okay, hold on a minute. Let me, because we're talking quite a bit. I'm just gonna quickly go to the fridge, get a beer, and I'll be right back. I'll be like 5 seconds. Okay.
Maybe we can get a sponsor. If you keep doing that, we can get a sponsor.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Well, what I was just gonna say was one of the things, interesting things in Taiwan, I've noticed, like the local people. So when I first got here, I remember many. So this is 2005 when I first got here, and. Okay, so it's 2005. I got here, and I was in Kaohsiung, and there was me, and there was another lad from England called what was his name? Can't remember his name now. Sorry, he probably forgets me. He was also from England. We arrived at pretty much the same time, and. So we were kind of excited to be in Kaohsiung. It was really good to have someone in the same position as yourself and from the same country, you know, and just go around and you know, and sort of take things in. And one of the things we did would be typhoons. It was our first typhoon. So being as we were both from England, and in England we don't have typhoons, we don't have earthquakes, we don't have any extreme weather events bar the odd flooding from time to time. So for us to have the first typhoon was quite exciting. I mean, now typhoons are a pain.
Which reminds me of a story my wife.
Oh yeah, same here. Yeah.
But anyway, continue.
I mean, typhoons now are a pain in the ass. Anyway, so the first typhoon, and we would go out on purpose with we had these little bicycles, and we'd go out on purpose in the typhoon and get knocked over. You know, the wind would knock you over and be like, oh, look, just roll out. And we used to go around to like just ride around like our little local neighborhood, looking at, you know, like, okay, here's the tea shop, and if you want the milk tea, you gotta ask for Naita, and we're just picking up little bits of language and stuff and going around doing things. And I remember we were going to a convenience store, like a Highlight or something, 7-Eleven, and we went to the fridge. And we said, let's get a beer, you know, because we hadn't had a beer. We couldn't go to the pub because we didn't have our paperwork through yet, and we didn't have our ID cards and all the rest of it. We're still waiting. So it was really, really early. We literally like a few days. So we went to the 7-Eleven and the fridge, and we're looking through the beers, and we didn't recognize any of the brands except one, which was this one, which is Heineken. Now Heineken is not a great seller in England, or at least the part of England I'm from. You might occasionally see like a pack of them in the supermarket, but they'll typically be outsold by other brands. And it's just a standard typical lager, really. So we ignored the Heineken, and it was the Taiwan beer. And the both of us, we looked at that and we said, that looks dodgy. The fact that it's called Taiwan beer, it's not even called Taiwanese beer, like they couldn't get that right. But then we looked at, there was a bunch of Japanese ones. And there was one, I ended up getting the silver Asahi. Yeah, it's like super dry. You know, like the Marvin, what's that song? The, Superfly. Anyway, so we ended up getting a couple of those, and they would taste really, really great. But, fast forward about 10 years, and I changed, and I started drinking the Taiwanese beer. Not only that, I started drinking the classic Taiwan beer, which is cheapest, instead of the gold label, the Jipak. So it's the cheapest, nastiest, you know, low-level beer that you can get in Taiwan. And I actually prefer it now. It's actually become my I actually prefer that to any other beer. But, I know, you probably, most of the people don't like it. I like it. It's an acquired taste. But the other thing is, I've noticed, if you, because I used to explain this, I used to say the Taiwanese people drink Taiwanese beer because it's part of an expression of nationalism. You know, we're Taiwanese, so we drink Taiwan beer. But I've noticed actually that a lot of the properly Taiwanese, you know, like all the Taiwanese people, they never drink Taiwan beer. They always drink Heineken. And I've always wondered about that. Is it some sort of a status symbol? Like if you drink Heineken, well, because Heineken is slightly more expensive than Taiwan beer, right? So if you get a Taiwan beer, it's like, was it like Sansa acquired, like $32 or something? And Heineken is like 45 or, I'm not sure, 47 or something? Whatever. But just kind of interesting that, like for example, this beer, I didn't buy this. So, I mean, you already know I didn't buy this. This is, my girlfriend came by last night, and her family recently did the bye-bye, which is like a local sort of religious custom, prayer ritual. They have a table, and they set up different types of food, dry packets of noodles, some fruit, some maybe chicken or fish, the whole chicken, yeah, some juice or some water, bottles of water, or in some cases beer. Temples more generally will be more interesting in some ways, because the temple architecture is quite interesting, I think, actually. But so beer, and of course when they finish the ceremony, the ghosts don't actually exist. They don't actually drink the beer, so that everything's still there. So, and her family doesn't drink. She and her mother and her father and brother, they don't drink beer. So she just comes over and gives it to me. All right, here's the foreigner. I give the beer to the foreigner. So. I occasionally get these free beers, you know. And the couch is both open. Neither am I now, really. I've cut down on alcohol in general a lot. Like I don't, you know, in fact most days I don't even have beer. I'll have one like maybe twice a week or something, but it'll be like this, you know, and that's it. It'll be maybe after I finish exercising, or if I'm sitting down and I'm trying to go through a bunch of papers about that's another story. I'm trying to look at a bunch of things about water policy, about sediment management. Yeah. For something like that, you probably need a beer.
You know what I found is that if I only drink, like, I don't drink about that much. Like, even if we go to, like, one of the seafood restaurants and some of these orders that are out there, whatever it is, where the beer girls come to buy, and so, I always, even if I drink just that much, for some reason, both the classes and the gold beer give me a terrible headache. I don't mean, like, the next day.
Maybe I had the same reaction at first, I can't remember, and then I just got accustomed to it and went away. I just like it. And the nice thing about the Taiwan beer is what you do is you don't buy the cans. Like this is, you can tell, I would never buy this because it's in a can. What you do is you buy the glass bottles. And the Jinpai comes in a green bottle, and the classic comes in a brown one. What you do is you buy the bottles and you recycle them. But this is a form of recycling which is actually very efficient, because all you're doing is you return your empty bottles to the 7-Eleven or something, or Susu Mai, like a little local shop where you bought it from. And they give you like $2 back for every bottle that you return. But the bottles then get taken out of the bag, loaded up onto a van or truck, and they get taken back to the local brewery. And all that happens is that they basically just steam off the labels, and use, wash them out, steam up the labels, and use them again, put, stick a new label on, and they get used again. So it's the perfect recycling scheme, because there's really, apart from the steam, the washing, this and take off the lid, there's not really, it's a very, very cheap, very efficient, very wasteless, I'm not sure if that's the word, waste-free or waste minimum way of recycling. Very efficient, it's very good. So, but also, in, quite interestingly, a form of recycling that doesn't really get much attention, because a lot of attention on recycling in Taiwan has always been recycling of either aluminum, as in aluminum cans usually, or the PET plastic bottles, you know, like water bottles and so on. Taiwan, in that respect, Taiwan is, if I remember correctly, Taiwan is actually better than Japan in terms of the rate of recycling of the plastic PET bottles. So Taiwan is pretty good on that. But let's leave that, because recycling is another topic of itself, which I think is a really, really, really great, interesting topic. And a lot of interesting stuff to talk about, and a lot of interesting research to be done on that. But I'll shut up for now. Yeah. What were we talking about? Yeah, you were talking about neighbor, and then... I think it's the same one I was mentioning earlier. Yeah, yeah. I think another one. Yeah.
Red bricks,
right? Red bricks, yeah. Mine is the same now. This is Kofo, by the way. Sorry, you're using your track sentences. He's everyone says that. Everyone says that, especially the girls, they love Kofo. They say he's the cutest one of all six dogs. But the thing is that they don't realize, because they don't live with him, he's actually the dumbest as well. He's really dumb. Earlier tonight I was walking the dogs. He's supposed to stay with me, and he found a bone, and he was just standing in the park chewing a bone. And even I called for him, he wouldn't come, because he just did a bone, that's it. He locked on the bone, and that's it. Everything else doesn't exist. And it's slightly dangerous, because there's a pack of dogs, sort of semi-stray dogs out in that park. And just earlier tonight, oh yeah, they will, and they would tear them apart. They tried to go for my white dog Wang Wang earlier tonight, but the alpha male, Lucky, he's called, he's a big brown bunch, strong, but like a barrel, like fat. And he must have ran like 30 or 40 yards, like a good distance. Like he was eating his food over there in the park, 30, 40 yards away. Wang Wang was just smelling something on the grass, 30, 40 yards away. And he ran over like, rah, this, like properly, like he was going to attack Wang Wang. But because he tunnel vision, he didn't see me. I was standing like, you know, maybe 10, 7 yards away or something. So I just ran in and I was like, I can't. I lost my temper, and I shouted, and, you know, and all the local people just stopped what they were doing, like, looked at me like, oh, because I was like, you know, yeah, no, I was like, oh,
stray dogs and all these things.
Yeah, one of these days I'm going to get a hold of them.
I would take a survey of the class, like, what would they do if a stray dog came up to them angry or whatever? It must have been like, I'd run away. It's the worst thing you could do. You have to, like, shout at them, then they'll get scared. Just get as big as possible, and, you know, sure you're not going to give them out. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Not intimidated.
Yeah. You don't even have to shout at them. You just stand where you are. Mm-hmm. You don't even have to do that. Just stand there. And just like, it's total attitude. It's the same as if you, because dogs are smart. You don't have to overemphasize in order for them to understand. You just stand there and like, what? Like literally like that. You just shrug your shoulders and just like, just stand there like, what are you going to do? And they'll just like, oh, they'll just stop and they'll walk away, typically. You might get the odd, you know, Mr. 1% dog who's a bit crazy. But that's 1%, that's very unlikely. So yeah, the dogs are smart, but I often work, because I drive out in the countryside on my motorbike to visit the different reservoirs and rivers, and I have to go drive around a lot. And I often have the situation of driving through or past a farm, and local, you know, the farmer will have like two or three dogs or more. And they'll all come running down the road and bah, 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 barking like, who are you? And it's just, the more you're familiar with dogs, the more you realize that you get to distinguish different types of bark. And it's just, it's 9 times out of 10, it's just a, who are you bark? You know, this is our place, what are you doing? Yeah, it's not aggressive, it's just like, it's just warning. You just stand where you are, it's like, you stand where you are, it's fine. Just, you know, and yeah, but you're right, don't. The last thing we'll do is try to run away.
You know, I mean, of course, it's
all, I mean, unless you're on a motorbike, and then just,
they're tearing out walls, they're ripping up their old floor, they're redoing the entire kitchen, they're putting in new ensuite and everything. And we had neighbors across the landing there from us. It's just on one side of the, either side of the landing, either side of the landing.
You have apartment.
You have apartments, like apartment rooms or whatever. And they started kicking up a huge fuss about all the noise. And, you know, they even called the police on our builders, on our construction people, or destruction people, if you will. And the police were like, well, did they start working before 9 o'clock? Because it's a rule, you know, like 9 to 5, you can do that kind of work. Before 9, you can have workers in, but they can't be making any noise, that kind of thing. And then after, or is it 8 o'clock? I think it's 9 o'clock, 9 to 5. Anyway, we didn't do anything illegal. We didn't, you know, yeah. Well, yeah, of course. And they didn't violate anything. Like even our neighbors, the people across the way, they said, you know, they didn't violate anything. It was after 9 o'clock. You know, so the police were kind of like, well, we can't do anything about it. Anyway, as an aside, what we ended up finding out later is that these people that live across the way actually wanted to buy the apartment, and my sister,
whatever. Yeah, it's a sensible rule, right? Yeah.
I think it was pretty cheap. It wasn't very expensive because it was. I mean, my sister-in-law is not loaded in, you know, it was more of an investment, I think. Probably, something like that, yeah, something like that. And then she stuck a few, you know, she stuck a bit into the renovation and everything. But anyway, and then after that happened...
Just out of curiosity, can I ask how much was it? Was it an expensive one or was it cheap?
Like our builders complained that...
Like 2 or 3 million?
Or hauling up, because we didn't have an
that's sort of what it
was. You know, they climbed up the stairs. And so they were bringing materials up,
yeah.
And you know, like they were
It'll be around 2 or 3 million. So
one would go downstairs, or one of them would go downstairs, the other one would be working, and then the guy would come up the stairs, and you'd have the neighbors just inside your house looking around, you know. And they're like, well, what? It's not your it's not your property, that kind of thing. And then finally, yeah, it's
stairs.
Yeah, well, that But at that time, like,
walking inside your house.
My sister-in-law about it, and she was in Taipei at the time, and she contacted a couple of people.
That's serious. That's a really serious dilemma. I walking in my apartment, or at least an apartment that I was renting, or in this case, you bought it, right? Or your wife's sister bought it. Yeah, I'd be like, get the hell out of here.
And during this whole period of time, like, they kept on calling and complaining about all the noise. They called the construction company, the construction company that was doing the work. They complained about the noise, and the construction company called my sister and all this sort of stuff. There's a police company out of here. And so finally, the neighbor lady told my sister-in-law. My sister-in-law had like a meeting with her or something because she kept on calling the construction company. And the Laubach, the boss, didn't want to handle it anymore. So he just asked my sister-in-law permission to give the neighbor lady just her phone call so they could talk directly. And so they did. And she came down from Taipei to meet with her. And she accused our builders of, now there was a dividing wall, right, between our apartment and their apartment, which we didn't do any work on. All they did was paint it. They repainted it. That's it. They reprimed it, repainted it. That's it. They didn't knock out any walls on that wall. But she said that the jackhammering from our workers had knocked some tiling in the bathroom tiling off the walls and destroyed their toilet. And so, in their bathroom. I don't know. They said the rattling from the...
Yeah.
Or even, I mean, if... Yeah, and not only that, but I mean... The tiling is mortared. I mean, you know, it's not mortared. No, but she said that they fell off, that they were knocked off, that they were rattled off until the tiles fell down. And so, anyway, my sister-in-law would
destroyed a toilet. That's an extraordinary claim.
On the bottom of
the rattling destroyed a toilet. A ceramic toilet.
The toilet where it gets attached to the floor, and then. And then one of the tiles in the bathroom
was good grout between
three
the
or
tiles,
four
right?
millimeters, sticking out 3 or 4 millimeters farther than the rest of the tiling. And she told my wife's sister that you're gonna pay for this, or I'm gonna sue you. And at that point, my wife's sister was like, what the, you know? But she's like, okay, exactly. And even if it did. I mean, that's a little bit extreme, you know. Like, I think there's whoever did your tiling is a bit.
Anyway,
and we didn't even do any jackhammering on that wall, so she's arguing that some other wall.
There's no evidence that the jackhammering caused either that crack in the toilet base or the slight extension of one tile.
Suing my wife's sister, and it wasn't even like a reasonable amount. It was like over $1 million she was suing my wife's sister for. And so, of course, I don't know if any of our viewers or you yourself have gone through the litigation process in any country, but this is my first litigation process in any country. And of course, they try to get the two parties to bargain some sort of an agreement. And my wife's sister, later on, like my wife's sister even offered her something like 50,000 NT just to kind of shut her up, and she wouldn't accept it. She wanted the million. 1.2 million NT, something like that. So anyway, yeah, exactly. And not only that, but it was just a ridiculous sum. And like to replace a toilet, even if we are, you know, culpable, if we are responsible for it, to replace a toilet, crack in a toilet, they were milking the whole situation. So anyway, during the whole litigation process, we just refused to kind of negotiate.
It's you can't give them money because they keep coming back for more. They just want more.
The lawyer said, no, we're not. I mean, we can negotiate with them, but I mean, we want to negotiate with reasonable people. And so we started getting like all sorts of weird things. We would get like in the middle of the night.
There's no way to pass 1 million.
It sounded like it's like a baseball bat or a pipe or something would get beaten against the wall from next door. Like you could tell it was next door because. The way that we had our bed situated was like our headboard was right up against the wall that divided our two apartments, my wife and my master bedroom. And they would be just bang, 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 bang at like 3:30 a.m. You know, And that happened quite a bit. And then I remember one morning, I just woken up, I went to the bathroom, and I could see like this, if you can imagine, the windows are not too far. We have this wall, and they were probably maybe like a meter, not even a meter, I would imagine like, less than a yard, a couple of feet maybe, from that wall to the window in our bedroom, and then, or one of the windows in our bedroom, and then their window was about that same distance. It was enough for a broomstick to reach. And because we were on the fifth floor, we didn't really have like the steel gating or the grating that's covering the windows to cover like
a yard or a couple of feet.
And we had some plants out there, and you could see that there was a broomstick. So it was not the separation was not so far that you could actually stick a broomstick up. And she started beating against the window with a broomstick, or someone in their house started beating with a broomstick. I don't want to jump to conclusions to who it was. And then they ended up knocking several of our plants down, about five stories, and breaking the pots and everything. And that kind of thing.
Several times
we came home, like we went, I think, one time to like Costco or something, and came back carrying things up the stairs human excrement
small.
Floor. I would guess it was human because it didn't smell like dog, and I don't know what other kind of excrement you would get. And they, I don't think they had a dog, you know, because dog shit and human shit smell different. The diets are different or whatever. And it was rank. It was more, I would say at least it smelled like human shit, but it was definitely excrement of some sort.
I didn't know it was human. Just a guess, right?
This happened like 3-4 times.
You knew what it was. It was just, yeah.
Until finally we just decided, okay, that's enough. We're going to get a security camera. And then as soon as we got the security camera put up like, right outside our door, just looking at the landing, was when we got when the police called us on us again because the neighbor said that we were using it to spy on them. So we had to go through and show the police what the camera was actually looking at.
Three or four times.
Police were like, no, they're not spying on you, they're just looking at the landing. It's totally fine. It's their property, and the landing is for your security, so you can't
injunction. An injunction. So that's a good thing.
This is a period of time, this is when my wife was pregnant. By the time, like, this was going on for, God, it was at least a year and a half, we were going back and forth with these people. And finally, in the end, we did have to go to court because she would not give in on anything. My sister-in-law, I think at one point, even got up to $70,000 just to kind of shut them up, and she refused to take it. So, I'm trying to think of what else happened. There's a lot of things. I'm leaving things out that you would get. What's that? Yeah, I'm trying to think of what it was. And there were lots of things that were going on. I don't know if they were a family. Like, you hear stories about people, a lot of gossip from the older neighbors and people who lived there long enough. But she was an older woman. She was probably somewhere around 60. And then I don't know if it was her husband or her boyfriend or even.
Be shocked to hear.
He was like in his 60s.
You're leaving things out that I would be shocked to hear. You can't remember that.
They would leave cigarettes on the landing, but they threw all the cigarettes on our side of the landing. So he'd come out, and before he went in, he'd just throw a cigarette on the landing at our door, kind of. I mean, we've even got a videotape of this happening. Just petty shit like that. Another thing, too, we had, we were in the wrong here, but it's kind of it's a little bit, the plot thickens a little bit, because we had technically it's an illegal sixth floor that they built on. It was like an apartment that my sister-in-law was going to rent out, what we ended up doing was they also when my sister-in-law redid the our apartment, she also redid the sixth floor and made it into an apartment for two-bedroom apartment. And
almost everybody in Taiwan has that, except me. I don't have, but everyone has that. Yeah.
Like a flat roof. Yeah.
So I just stop you there, Nate, just so everyone understands that. So what we're talking about is, because you don't see this in either England or the United States, or I guess France or Germany either. What you'll typically have in Thailand is in a typical Taiwanese house, it's basically essentially a large concrete box, which tends to be narrow, fairly long, and high. So there's the dimensions are sort of like this, and it's basically a box with a flat roof, and to drain, which is quite strange actually. We should have another talk about architecture. The drainage pipes are usually fitted inside the house, which is another problem altogether. But then sometimes what people will do, so you'll have, like, for example, a standard house, maybe three floors, or it might be four floors, but then what a Taiwanese family will do typically is on top of that, at the top of the house, they will then use corrugated iron, using sheets of corrugated iron, they'll build an additional set of walls with a sloped roof on top, built from corrugated iron, making a false floor, making a six floor, whatever level it is. And so this is like an additional part of your house. The advantage is that you create more space, more living space for your house. So if you have relatives sleeping over, or you have want to do some washing or something at the top there, you can do it. But also, there's a disadvantage, which is that it's illegal. And the reason it's illegal is due to the building codes, which are there ostensibly, and partly, there are other reasons as well, but partly and ostensibly to limit the fallout damage from earthquakes. The buildings have to be below a certain height, given certain other conditions. They have to be below a certain height for earthquake safety. And this building code is routinely flouted all the time. Not just the building code about height, but the building code in other dimensions as well. For example, the width of a house. So you'll have a demarcated area of land that you can build on, and then typically a person will buy that land and then build their house maybe a foot or even a yard or so over that line. So they're actually taking up what is technically public property, but by the time the house is built and someone has filed a complaint to the government, they can't really do anything about it. I mean, what are they going to do, come down and order the house to be torn down? That's it's extreme. So. For my neighbors just across the street from me, apparently this is true of their house, but it just so happens that nobody minds. I don't mind. Nobody else minds.
Which is really funny. I have to say it's really funny for two reasons. Okay. The first reason is that they also...
Well, the engineers would say the building code is there for a reason, which is to do with...
But they were
using
that as like an argument to try to...
Oh, sure. Yeah, it's not a big deal. I don't care. It's like, yeah, okay.
Mentioned this to the judge. You have a fake sixth floor. My sister-in-law was kind of like, well, so do you. And that's exactly what the judge said. But then the funny thing, the second funny thing is that after we finished this lawsuit,
six.
Then
that's neat. Okay.
Was told that she could continue building the legal sixth floor by the judge. It's kind of funny. Because we actually started construction, and we had to stop construction. No, but it makes me. My point is that it makes me question what is illegality. You know, like the judge doesn't. Yeah.
No, well, the judge. I think the judge is right, because if I remember correctly from the conversation I was having,
yeah.
Well, that's what I was going to point out was that the laws are there. Part of it. I mean, this is another topic. Some of the laws or regulations in town, as I think this is also true to some extent in Western in England and the States, that they're there for one ostensible reason, but the real purpose is often to be used as a weapon. And so you'll get this where basically, for example, another example which illustrates the point much more clearly is parking spaces outside of restaurants. So when I used to live in Kaohsiung, my go-to example on this is, again, from when I was living in Kaohsiung, there was I can't remember the road names, because it's so long since I've been there now. There was a little hot pot restaurant, a traditional hot pot restaurant, on just off Jenggo Road and then another road, I think it was called now, near Dashun Road, just from there, closer to Chenjing Lake. And it was very, very popular. I would go there like two or three times a week, and I'd always have the same thing and a bunch of eggs, and the girl knew me and everything. I don't even need to order anything. She knew what I wanted. And I'd bring friends there sometimes. And so I'd always park there. There's a very small white box, which is used as a kind of parking lot. But actually, that little white box is a turning bay. So the road was on a sort of T-junction, right? So you get your T-junction, and this is the main road. The vertical one is the main road, and the horizontal one is a little cul-de-sac road, which just leads down. It's just a kind of little alley, leads down to surrounded by apartments. It's a cul-de-sac. This is the main road, and there's a traffic light system. So if you were on the main road and you wanted to turn into that cul-de-sac, what you would do if you were coming this way, you're driving on the right-hand side of the road, is that you wouldn't make that left turn. The left turn in Taiwan is illegal for motorcycles and scooters. So what you have in a car, it's fine, but on a scooter, you're supposed to drive up to the little bay, wait in the little bay for the green light on the main road to turn red, and then the green light for the little road to turn on, change from red to green, and then you leave the little parking bay, the little turning bay, and drive straight into your cul-de-sac. Now, that little turning bay, which serves the cul-de-sac, was located directly outside this very, very popular hot pot restaurant. And so you would typically have people parked with the rear wheels of their motorcycles in that little turning bay and along the street, and there'd be a red line there indicating you can't park, or a yellow line. There's a red line or a yellow line. Red line in Taiwan means you can't park. Yellow line means temporary parking is allowed. And the white line is, or no line at all, is it's okay. And so people would be parked there, their scooters and motorcycles outside there, and you'd go into the restaurant and you'd be eating your food. Now, because that turning bay, you're supposed to use the turning bay, but if you were slightly outside the turning bay and you wanted to make that turn, that's fine. The cops would never pull someone over for that. It would be fine. And that's what happened. There was no demonstrable harm happening to anyone by people parking with their wheels slightly in the turning bay. However, what would happen would be that every now and again the cops would come over, what happened was that one of the other restaurants further up the road, another hot pot restaurant, which wasn't so popular, which wasn't doing such great business, they got annoyed. Yeah, they got annoyed. And all it is they're looking to find some small violation of an outdated or archaic or semi-useless regulation. All the cops on them on this account. The cops know what the deal is. The cops know this is exactly what's going on. And the cops will even admit to you, like, yeah, no, it's just, you know. But Yeah, I mean, the cops are people too, right? So, and so it was. It was just they're jealous that this restaurant is doing very well and getting lots of customers because everyone likes their food or whatever, and the civil place is not so good. And that was it. That's all it was. That's all it was to it. And I mean, I got annoyed as well because I could have said to them, I said, look, I don't know about other people, but I'll tell you the reason why I like this hot pot restaurant and I never go to yours. Okay, so yours looks nicer, actually. This one doesn't look so good. Their restaurant, the one that wasn't doing well, actually looked nicer.
It smells terrible.
But the reason I never used it was because they use the oil, you know, like they have the hot pot, right? And you have like a little a base of oil. The oil one, right? They come around with a light or something and they light the oil underneath the lid. But this one, the one everyone liked, which looked much more sort of basement. Yeah, they had the propane thing. They just gas cylinder, switch it on, like you do your cooker in your kitchen, right? And you can alter the flame as you want, turn it up, turn it down, if you want. The oil gives you less control. It's probably cheaper for them to use the oil. It smells as well, yeah. So propane is just cleaner. And you've got more control over it and stuff. And that was the reason. I think, or at least that was one of the reasons. So, but yeah, that kind of petty thing that happens all the time where people in Thailand will use local regulations and local little as weapons. Yeah, so when the judge says to your sister-in-law that she can carry on the building on the sixth floor, the judge is, in a sense, you turn around and say, well, the judge shouldn't be saying that because it's technically legal. On the other hand, I think it may be, I don't know, I may be wrong on this, but it may be that
I didn't go to any of the
way that the law is framed or the way that the regulations are framed are that the police and the courts are not allowed to do anything unless someone specifically has a legitimate complaint about it or has a specific complaint. The police are supposed to investigate all complaints, but if someone has a legitimate complaint about it, then the court can take action. But I mean, I might be wrong, and maybe more. I suspect it's much more complicated than that. So the judge was probably.
My sister-in-law and her husband.
Yeah.
Divorce, but then, so that was one thing that she had to work on. But also, my son was there, and we still had some. Even though they got that money from us, they never really stopped causing us trouble. Like every once in a while, you'd still get the banging at night, and. After my son was born, we just decided, wow,
it's too much.
My sister-in-law decided to sell the place after talking to my wife about it. Like, we were not, I don't know, in some ways my wife is quite modern in the sense that she's not into like the superstition and stuff like this, but in some ways she's still kind of conservative in the sense that she believes in a lot of the superstitions, and she had like a bad, you could say feng shui, that kind of thing, and just... to have my son there, to have a new life there. I think she was just kind of uncomfortable with having like a baby, you know, having him being there by himself, like not by himself, but you know, he'd be old enough to walk and go out. What would happen, you know? And I think I agree with her too at that point. Like, you don't know. I mean, they can't really do anything to us. Like, they never did anything to me directly, but they did all sorts of shit to my wife when they knew that I wasn't around. And like, they would never dare, you know, do anything to me because. Like I said, they would bang, especially before we had the camera. And they would just start banging on the door, and she would, like, my wife would open up the door, for away the camera, and the woman would like, I want to talk to you about this, whatever. And the old man would be standing right behind her, and kind of.
I agree with her.
It's kind
of
threatening.
It's not
some old 60-year-old woman. It's also her husband. And she's like, I'm not going to let you into my house. I'm here all alone. You know, but. When they knew that I was home.
What sort of things?
And that was done purposely by me, first of all, because after I found out about it, like, you know, I could speak Chinese. I said stuff to them, and, you know, I gave them dirty looks and things like this. And there was one time where I think she didn't know, the old lady didn't know that I was home. And so as soon as she heard, like, me rustling in the background and walking towards the door, she actually left. Like, she kind of, like, ran away.
Yeah.
And so my wife was like, yeah, she's afraid of you, so... If ever that happens again, you just come here. You just answer the door. I'm like, oh, okay, yeah. So, yeah, that ended up dying down after we had the camera.
They wouldn't come. Yeah.
We'll have many discussions about work, I'm sure.
Well, that's, I'm telling you the story that's very, very similar to that. So some years ago, I used to work at another, I was working somewhere else, which I'm not working at anymore. I was working at another place, which I'll leave the name out for the time being, but... We can do this specifically if we want to do it later. This company had two bosses, and male and female. And many of the employees, myself included, had a number of legitimate complaints against them. Ranging from people not getting paid on time, to people not getting paid at all, to all kinds of dodgy things happening. And now, in the early days of the company, I was one of the first people to join. There was one moment when the female boss had an argument with me. She shouted to me over the phone slightly, and she never did it again because I immediately shot back at her because I was in the right in this particular instance. Otherwise I would have accepted the bollocking, you know, if I'd been wrong. But I was right, and I shoved it back at her, and she never tried that again with me. A few years later, as the company expanded, there was one time I was at another branch, the head branch as it was, as it later became the head branch, and there was a really beautiful Taiwanese woman working there, whom I quite liked. She was really nice, and she liked me a lot. But she was also working there, and I was in the foyer of the main office, and I was doing some paperwork. So I wasn't working as such, I was just doing some paperwork, finishing something off. And she came downstairs from having had a meeting with the two bosses in their office, and she came downstairs in the foyer, and she talked to the girl on the counter, the admin girl on the counter briefly, and then she came over to me, and she sat down and she was crying. She had her head in her hands and she was crying. And I spoke to her. I said, "Well, what's wrong? What's okay? What's wrong?" No. She had a legitimate complaint. The two bosses called her in, and it started screaming at her, like shouting. Apparently, what she said, shouting, screaming at her. Now, I'm taking her word for it, because I didn't see what happened, but she said that they were shouting and screaming at her, and I said, "Well, what for?" And when she explained to me, I'll leave it out for now, but when she explained to me what it was that they were shouting and screaming at her about, I couldn't believe it. It was a small thing. Now, if you're an employer, and if your employee makes a small mistake is still a mistake. And for someone else to say that it's small, it can perhaps be an opportunity. Yeah. So they have a right to criticize the employees for making mistakes. But I mean, from what she told me, I was amazed. What she told me was slightly inaccurate, I don't know. But to be shouting and screaming at her, was a bit over the top. And I said to her, you know, that I've made worse mistakes than what she's made, and they've never shouted and screamed at me. And I think what was happening there was just straightforward bullying. That they were bullying her, but they would never have bullied me, because they'd get bullied back.
It's always like the very rare 5% of people who don't back down.
I think that's quite common. Yeah.
Shouting outside and things like this, and they wanted to fight and that kind of thing. But I find in most situations that, in general, I'm speaking in general, yeah, typically they, I find that once you demonstrate and you've drawn a line in the sand, you're not going to accept the kind of thing. Typically, people will back down. I find, which is, I think, a good thing, obviously, because I mean, my I'm just thinking back up to when I was younger, and I come from a culture where, I mean, basically, little boys fight all the time. You know, I mean, we get in fist fights all the time. That's like the worst thing you can do. I mean, if you want to avoid conflict, the worst thing you do is puff up your chest. That's just a challenge. Whereas to avoid conflict in that situation is to walk away. But I find that in Taiwan, it's actually the opposite.
I think if I go outside, actually,
they tend to use that to kind of demonstrate that you're kind of a weakling or whatever. But in Taiwan, it's kind of, if you go like this, usually they're, oh, oh shit, and then they kind of leave you alone. You know, they either think you're crazy, or they realize that that's not a fight that I'm going to have right now. So I don't know if you've had a similar situation like that, but just talking about bosses and work-related situations, I find that not even bosses, just things on the street usually too. When you get someone who's aggressive, it's kind of a faux aggressiveness. It's not really, it's kind of like they're testing you more than anything. It's not necessarily like they're challenging you. And once they realize that he's not easily challenged, or he will challenge me back, I find that they typically back down. Typically. Now that, again, that's general. Like, it's a generalization. It's not a rule, but it's a generalization. I don't know if you find that to be. Just general situations. Let's see if I can think of an example. But there was there were several times in Taiwan actually where I've been like threatened, especially like on the roads, like where you'll get and then the minute that you're not going to drive away, that if they want a problem, yeah, you're going to give them a problem. They usually just decide, okay, drive away, that kind of thing.
What do you mean by on the street? I mean, typically. So I can't think of any example. I mean, apart from the homeless thing that just happened the other day, and apart from
because I just like wasn't expecting a stick for something like that, that kind of thing. But generally, I find, especially with work related things, that again, in general.
Oh, right, with like driving altercations.
Demonstrate that you're not going to put up with that kind of crap. Is basically when they realize that they can't do it to you. Like that kind of play doesn't work. That makes any sense, but I don't know if you've had any similar situations like that. But the worst thing I've realized is that you do it to Taiwan. Like, again, it's a cultural thing, I think. Do what most Taiwanese people do, which is take your complaints home with you and don't complain at work. Like, you know what I mean? That for me, I've never really understood that. But I mean, I see it from lots of different people. Like, they'll take their, they don't complain about work at work. It's like they take it home and complain about it to their families. And for me, it's like, work stuff. Complain to your superior. That's why you have a superior. But then they'll always, typically, they'll come back and say, well, the company will use that to fire you. Well, if the company will use a minor complaint to fire you, you probably don't want to work for that company. But, I don't know. That's not true, though.
Yeah, that's, Yeah, but then the kind of claim is that all the other companies are the same, which is not true. But it's not true. But but it's more complicated than that. I mean, it's much more complicated than that. I had an ex-girlfriend who used to complain to me about when she'd go to work, and the older women in the company would bully her. She was the younger woman. She was 23, I think, at the time, and I'll leave out the name of the company. It's a large company, and famous large company, and they employed some older women as well, and the older women would try to force the work that they hadn't finished and force it onto her and tell her to finish, and then she'd say, well, why do I have to do it? And they turn around and say, well, because I'm married and I have children and you don't, so you have to finish my extra work for me. Whereas I turn around and I said, well, why don't you just tell them to fuck off? basically. Well, why don't you just tell them, you do your work, I do my work, and go come by the supervisor. And I said, no, she was just back there in front of me. And, I think it's all to do with, one, I think, perceived relationships between these old women and the supervisors, and two, expectations, perhaps wrong, but expectations that the supervisors, maybe they are aware or could be made aware of what's really happening, but just don't care. And we'll just take the easiest solution. Okay, get rid of the troublemaker. Why get rid of three older women who've been here for a while when you can just get rid of the new girl? It's easier and cheaper to get rid of the new girl than to get rid of the women who've been here for 10 years. So in that case, you can sometimes have people who've been in an organization for a long time and who can then become, in a sense, in a smaller sense, because they're relatively in low positions in the company, they can be corrupt by what little power and by what little power that they have, they are corrupted. And it gets taken out on the young girls who are joining.
Worked at before, not just in teaching places, but I used to work as a writer and an editor for a publishing company also. I find that management, especially bosses, enjoy I would say unfriendly competition between employees, to the point where it also almost becomes toxic to the work environment. And I don't know why that is, but I find that typically bosses in places like that, especially smaller companies, again, I'm jumping to conclusions, and we can discuss this at a later time. But I find that bosses and managers in those places tend to be highly insecure. It's very, very insecure. They like to sow discord among employees. And I think you've got a point here with that. That it's almost to their benefit. The infighting means that they're focusing on each other, not on the boss, not on the manager's position. They're fighting with each other. I don't know if that's. I mean, maybe I'm reading a little bit too much into it. Maybe it's because of my reading of Sun Tzu's Art of War, that kind of thing. But it is almost like an ingrained thing in culture that. If you can manipulate things into your favor by controlling what other people do and have them focus on each other, the conflict with each other, they don't focus the conflict up, which could be a way to maintain control of a company, to maintain a control of the workforce. I don't know. I find it to become very, very toxic if that's happening inside of a company, especially if you want your company to be competitive with other companies. But then again, if that's common in most companies, then it's almost a workplace culture thing, which is, yeah.
Well, it's another topic to come back to. I mean, I used to, I know an LED factory here in Thailand that is more modeled after an American management culture. And although they did have their fair share of problems, it seemed to be far superior to things I've seen elsewhere in other companies in Taiwan. And some of them would have stories of, comparative stories of the companies that they used to work at and why they left and why they came to this particular LED company. And they would say things like nepotism, things like, for example, the son maybe would have the boss would have a son who would be working at the company doing the same job as another guy. And yet, when it came around to Chinese New Year, the employee who was doing basically the same job as the son would get like a red envelope with maybe 1,000 NT. 1,000 NT, which is like, what's it, like 15 quid or something. And I don't know if that is US. Is that US? 30 bucks? Like $30 or whatever. And then, which we never get. although, to be fair, some buses are quite nice, and they will sometimes give you a little extra bonus. It changes me. Yeah, even if you don't deserve it. But the sum would get, you know, so the regular employees could walk away with a red envelope with $1,000 doing the same job as the son, who may have done a poor job, you know, relatively speaking, would walk away, he'd walk away with a new car. You know? And so people would get fed up with that kind of thing and they'd quit. So that's kind of interesting as well, because that also indicates that if people are quitting on things like that, I mean, it may be that they say they quit for this reason, and maybe that they quit for a number of other. So I think it's more likely that there was a cluster of reasons why they quit these places. But at least if that's cited among those reasons, then I think, you know, it may be the case that Taiwan, you know, an indication that Taiwan is changing, that the work culture is starting to change. But where the worry with that is that as the work culture changes, the direction in which it's changing is the American direction, and then the worry there is that as you know if that occurs blindly, then Taiwan will also see a sort of blind adoption. I think it already has this looks a blind adoption of the all this nonsense in the U.S. and Europe now about.
I've already predicted that. Yeah.
No. Specifically, I was going to say the whole gender pronoun thing. Jordan Peterson was arguing about the gender pronoun thing. The sexism, racism, misogynistic, Islamophobic, xenophobic. That list of identity politic complaints, I think we're going to see more and more of that in Taiwan. I mean, I think we've already seen quite a lot. I think we're going to get more of that in Taiwan.